1. We're sort of backslidden. It's taken us 29 classes. 29 classes to get to verse 28. That's a class per scripture. That's not bad. That's better than John class. Amen. I want to kind of, since I've been gone 2 Thursdays, I think it is, I want to kind of go back through some things in that we've looked at in relationship to the captivity and in relationship to the Day of Atonement, but all connected to the progression of the book of Romans. And then, depending on how well we do, I would like to do something that I said that I would do somewhere along the line of 29 classes, that I told you I would compare Romans, the captivity, and the Day of Atonement with the book of Genesis, the beginning, the very first presentation of everything. And there we find the same pattern. There we find God does not change. And we find the truth lying still in a person, the truth still being God's greatest reality, being his son. Let's start in Romans again, just to read one verse out of Romans chapter 1, verse 28. verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, okay, that's, I'm just meditate on that for a second. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. You see this in relationship to the captivity, that God loved Israel, that God brought them out of bondage. It's interesting that they're being captive to Babylon. It's called captivity. But when it refers to the Exodus, it's called bondage, the house of bondage or bondage and that sort of thing. And God prepared a place for them to go. He knew beforehand. He knew as far back as Abraham. So, you know, and he told Abraham, I have a place that I will reveal unto you, something that it was of his heart, something that he'd prepared before he prepared them. Something that was before the foundation of them. And he brings them to this place and he establishes all of these amazing things, the temple and the worship and all this stuff. And in that place, they leave God. In that prepared place. And so we find in Romans 1 that this is the place where they began to, I mean, God has brought them to it. He's shown himself. He's made himself known. And those of you who were in our first couple of classes when we got into Romans know that what happened wasn't just sin, people sinning. What happened is they didn't just leave God either. They exchanged his glory and his image and everything else for things that were more like an unto man and creepy things. And in that sense, they left him, in that sense. So then comes the captivity. So that's Romans 1. Romans 2 begins with the goat being sent into the wilderness, or Judah going into captivity. He turns them over to a reprobate mind. Okay, that's the captivity. And so in Romans 2, the scapegoat is sent into the wilderness. And Judah is sent into Babylon. And he turns over to a reprobate mind that which he loved and wanted for his own as one with him. He did that because of this leaving and this changing and this desire to have it our way. And I'd mentioned this before, but the reprobate mind is the captivity. And we see that in Romans 7, and we address that with a couple of scriptures that literally said, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin and death. So I wrote this, and I'd said things similar to this in the past. They were already acting like heathen, so God joins you to them to serve their purposes. I think this is, I've seen this in my years of being a pastor. I've seen this happen with people. I've seen it, where they're in the place that God has for them. He brought them to that place. The Lord freely is opening his heart, and they continue to act contrary to what and who they are in Christ, in the Lord. See, in Christ is a doctrine, but in Jesus is not, if you know what I mean. I mean, the way I'm trying to put it. So he joins them to that which they have loved. It's probably like Hosea. I wouldn't doubt it. It should be like pretty much every pattern that you see leads to this same thing. He joins them to what they love. And in so doing, they begin to serve their purposes. Well, they're still serving a purpose, but they're not serving God's purpose. They're serving not even their own purpose, which is funny because that was what they wanted before they went into captivity. They're serving the heathen's purposes. And captivity is a great picture of that. So that is the second goat being released into a land uninhabited. That doesn't mean they don't speak of God, but it's uninhabited. God isn't there. You know, kind of like the tabernacle at Shiloh. You remember that? And after they took the Ark of the Covenant, after the Philistines took the Ark of the Covenant, they still continued to do all the things that they did, but God was no longer there. All of the things now are totally rituals, which they may have been rituals before. Do you understand? Because this is the pattern. You have to see, this is the pattern. God, if it's not going to be real, and if it's not going to be life, then this is the pattern. And so he sends them to a land of people that are like them, and he sends them to a place where you can still go through the motions in Shiloh, but you have absolutely no real contact. Not in a living way. You know, it doesn't mean God's not there. Doesn't mean God doesn't have, you know, doesn't mean he's not all-knowing or all-powerful, and, you know, but it means that they have lost touch with the original intention of his heart. Okay, well, how easy is that to do if you never ever talk about the intention of God's heart. You only talk about what he's done for you. You're destined to go there. On some level, you're destined to go there. The good news is, that's not the end of the pattern. That's the good news. Praise God. There is a Romans 3 and 4 and 5 and 6. And it gets better. So then Romans 3, and it deals with the first goat being killed, which is Jerusalem being destroyed, or Christ being crucified. And as you know, that's what halfway through Romans 3, it introduces the dead one who died for you so that you could be brought back. Romans 3, if you know Romans 3. It introduces, now there is a way back into God apart from the law and apart from your failures. Okay. It introduces the destruction. Chapter 3, Romans 3, introduces the destruction of Jerusalem, or the death of Christ, or the death of the first goat on the Day of Atonement. And then Romans 3 and 4 together, particularly 4, introduces Judah returning from captivity, or the scapegoat returning from the land uninhabited, or the coming back to and the receiving of the burnt Jerusalem, or the burnt offering. To receive it, not just to believe in it in a foreign land, but to come back to it and build based on it. It's how you build now. It's how you think now. You've received the death of Christ. You've received the burnt Jerusalem. The scapegoat has come back and has left a land uninhabited and comes back to discover all the reality that God originally intended. That's the key. That's always the key. It's always the key, folks. To go to his heart, you know, to find his heart. That's always what he wants. It's always what he wants. It's just the way that he is. And I know that sounds weird to talk about God that way, but I'm convinced, and we'll see that as we get into probably tonight, Lord willing, you know how that goes. But as we get into the second part of Romans 5, oh man, everybody sees something, but they don't see his heart there. And it's really beautiful. All right, we're moving along pretty good. All right, what I want to do is what I promised you that we would do, is that we would see these three things: the Day of Atonement, the captivity, and Romans in relationship to the death of Christ. We would see them all three as presented and clear in the first part of the book of Genesis. So that, and you know the name Genesis means beginnings, right? Beginning. And I personally believe this. I think there are a lot of reputable people that believe this, but I believe that the seed of every truth that God wants is found in Genesis, the beginnings of it. Not the full, you know, day, not the full noonday, but there, if you look, you will find all of these things given to us in seed form, in beginning form. Seed would be a beginning, tree would be much growth, fruit would be even further down the road. So, let's first start with Israel again. I wrote, Israel was brought by God into a perfect place that he had chosen, a place of his choosing, a land of milk and honey. All right, God called it that. All right, so we go, I've been to Jerusalem and it's pretty much rocks and dry, and you know, if anybody's even seen pictures, you kind of go, this ain't no land of milk and honey. But he said wonderful things about this place and told Israel about it and told them that this is a place that drinks in the water of heaven. And I mean, he just goes on and on. I mean, he waxes eloquent about this land that is so, that he so wants them with him in it. And it's just, if you really read it from that perspective of his heart, oh my God, this is it. This is what he wants. So, Israel is, they weren't even, Israel wasn't even really a nation until God brought them out of Egypt. They were a people, but they weren't a nation. They became slaves down there, but they were brought out as a nation. That was the birth of the nation. The death of the lamb, the blood on the doorpost, crossing the Red Sea, that birthed them as a people of God. Okay. So they go across the wilderness and they come to this land and God brings them in and he rolls Jordan River back, and he's with them in their battles when they're with him. Isn't that funny how that works? I mean, the first battle, man, Jericho, great battle. They just walked around and blew trumpets. And it's like, this is easy. And then they go to Ai and somebody sees something that they like and hides it and takes it home. And you're talking to the dude and you're going, what are you doing with that Babylonian garment? You think you're going to wear that on the Sabbath or something? just really, our minds are something. we won't notice someday when you whip it out. Gosh. But nonetheless, that's what happened. That's exactly what happened. And then everything goes bad and they lose and they all, go back and punt and say, God, what happened? We thought you were with us. See, that's the deal. And he said, I thought you were with me. And to be with him, we can either be a Pharisee or we can be a lover, if you know what I mean. I mean, we can either be a Pharisee that says, I'm with you because I'm with your word and I'm with every scripture and I'm, we're vehement in our religion, but we're not really with him. We haven't seen his heart. But it is a sincere attempt to be with the Lord. Who was it? Mark Twain said, the streets of heaven are paved with good intentions. No, sorry. He said the streets of hell. All right. So it was there, and I made this statement earlier, it was there in that perfect place prepared by God that Adam sinned. We want to talk about the nature of that sin a little bit as we go, but so we're going to see Genesis, and I'm not going to, because you do realize we're getting close to the end of this one too, and we're only halfway through Romans 5. So what I'm going to do is, instead of doing all of the references in Genesis, I'm going to hope that you've read your Bible at least once from the beginning. Okay. All right. So we're going to compare the fall and Genesis and all of that to Romans 1 through 5, because that's how far we've gotten to this point, 1 through 5 and a 5, half a 5, half 5. What time is it? I'm confused. All right, so Adam starts out in a perfect environment again, one of God's choosing, one of God's placement, one one that was there before Adam was there. I want y'all to keep seeing this reality. That's why Jesus was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world, folks. It's exactly why, because the lamb was before us. We go, well, no, you know, you got to understand the way God views and the way God moves and the way he sets things up. So Adam and Eve, they're in this environment that is pristine. It is chosen of God. It is, if you will, the garden of his heart. And he opened it, just like Romans 1, just like that. And he opened that to someone, what? That he opened it to someone he trusts? No. I don't think he ever trusted anybody but Jesus and the Holy Spirit. I mean, I'm guessing. He opened it to someone who would become one with him and therefore he could trust because they are Jesus. They are one with Jesus. They are bride. They are bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh. So he opened it to oneness with the possibility of being trampled. Okay? And then Adam sinning. That's our so common way that we say it to avoid God's heart. It's theology. We sinned. That's all we did. We just sinned. And Jesus is a savior from sin. Who's going to save him, his heart from us? If that's all it was, then there's a big problem still going on. Does that make sense? So Adam left God as he wanted to be related to and as he wanted to be known. All right, so this is to leave the original intention of God. What? To be sinless? Really, that wasn't even an issue until, you know, Satan showed up, and then it wasn't an issue until, you know, they partook of the fruit. But to partake, they didn't have a sin nature. Romans 5, the second half will prove that. They didn't have a sin nature. That didn't start until Adam sinned. They had free will, didn't they? They had to, really, because God said, don't do this. I'm putting this in your hands. But they didn't have a sin nature, but they had the capacity to not choose God. And when I mean that, I mean not. I'm not saying to choose sin. I'm saying to leave, even if they didn't understand, to leave what God's original intention and heart was for them. To leave that. Now, you know, we're theologians and all of us, we make such a big deal out of the sin of it. You know, you ate that. Oh my God, what a horrible thing to do. You've cast the whole world into sin. Never eat fruit. That's the worst. That's by far the worst ever. Yeah, murder, not so bad. Eating fruit. You know, are you getting my point? You know, I could list off a lot of horrendous sins, but you ate fruit. Okay. Any thinking person, excuse me, would go, you know, this seems kind of weird that the whole thing, you know, rested upon not, you know, staying away from fruit. I think maybe it was more what was going on in them than what they did. You ever heard of the word motivation? It comes from the word motive. And the motives come from your heart. choices come from your will, thoughts come from your mind, but your heart is where motive comes from, and motive motivates you. All right. So we have no explanation in Romans 1. Why did you people, having known God, having seen his image, because to change the image like an unto whatever is to have seen the image. Why? I mean, especially in Romans 1 and 2, you just kind of go, why would you do that? You know? Well, I know exactly why. I know exactly why. Because they had not reached his original intention yet. They didn't know the true intention of his heart, and which is to be one with his son, and in so doing, bringing forth proper fruit, you know, because you have the proper roots and the proper seed and the proper everything else. We'll see this in Romans 5, so I'm not going to carry on that too much. All right, so left God as he wanted to be related to and known. Any leaving of God according to how he wants to be related to and known is idolatry. Because it's worshiping God not as he is, but as we've made him. Am I right or wrong? I mean, you can take a piece of wood, chop a couple of eyeballs in it, and go, ooh, that's God. It's doing the same thing. It's you coming up with your idea what you're going to worship. Are you accepting that idea from someone else? How important is it that we all know the word? How important is that we all have a relationship with the Holy Spirit? How important is it that we pursue him, Jesus, by the word and by the Holy Spirit in a true heart? Let us draw near with a true heart. That's what it says in Hebrews. Well, I just thought that meant, you know, come in like a priest. You know, okay, I'm a priest, you know. Yes, Lord. Where's your heart? Where's your heart? You know, Paul even addressed this when I think it was the Corinthians, they wanted to give to this thing that they were taking, this offering that they were taking for the saints in Jerusalem, and weren't able to do so. And he said, heart stuff counts. Oh, I know, I didn't say it, those words. He said, if it was already in your heart, then it's counted as if you already gave. But we go, oh, well, that's a good license for getting away with all kind of stuff. How about heart stuff counts when it comes to God? It counts. And head and hands and feet stuff don't count unless his heart is in the body. You know, I mean, we all do realize that we're all messed up, don't you? I mean, we're all messed up, all of us. I don't care how good you think you are, or I think I am, or whatever, we're all messed up. We need Jesus, and we need him right now in evaluating what's being said, as well as the Holy Spirit. Or we'll just go, oh, I don't know about that. Never, you know, we won't go, so I'm going to write it down, I'm going to search it out, and I'm going to ask God to show me. We go, I don't know about that. So it's forgotten, pushed out, never to be addressed again, unless the subject comes up again 3 to 7 years later. And then we go, well, I don't know about that. Well, you should have. It was brought up 7 years ago. And you should have done more than, I don't know. You should have said, I want to know about that, Lord. And to allow God to mold us. But you can't be passive and be molded. Isn't that interesting? You say, well, you just got to be limp clay. You got to be his clay. You got to be clay in his hands. Does that make sense? You know, we go, oh, there's clay. Well, you're not his clay in his hands. You're just a lump. You know what I'm saying? Oh, I'm his. I belong to him. When's the last time he touched you? I don't remember, but I know one thing. I belong to him. As if that's all that counts. Well, you know, I'm on his table. I've been here 20 years. God will do something when he wants to. Lord, I want to be clay in your hands. You're the potter. I'm not, you know, we're always working on us. Stop it. You're not the potter. You know? And go, I want to look like this. He doesn't want you to look like that. But it's for him. He doesn't want that. He wants you to be one with him. Look like you're one with him because you are. Okay, I'll be nice again. So, Adam and Eve, they left the intention of God, and so the garden, there was the death of the garden, never to be seen again, never to be entered into again. It's gone. Always has to be somebody that dies, and the garden didn't do anything wrong. Amen? The garden was perfect without sin, you know? So the garden dies. The angels shut the way for it because people go, oh, you know, I'm an archaeologist and I'm going to find where the Garden of Eden was. Yeah. And we're going to get back to the garden. We used to say that as hippies. We got to get back to the garden. You're going to have to go through two angels with swords. You ain't going back. Back is not where God wants us. Forward into Christ, into his fullness, not back into innocence. You know. All right, so then Adam is driven out. What does that sound like? There's the death of Jerusalem, there's death of the garden, then Adam is driven out of what God intended. Israel is driven out into captivity. The scapegoat is driven out into a land uninhabited. Does this sound familiar to anyone? Does this sound like, oh my God, this could possibly be really true what Randy's been teaching all along? There might be some truth to this. Really? Yeah, it took us a little while to get there. All right. And so Adam and Eve are sent into a foreign land. What is that foreign land? Anything outside of the garden, anything outside of Christ is a foreign land. It's heathen. It's heathen. And they're sent into that, and it is a world that's different from the world they were in. It is a world that grows thorns, and it is a world that they have to work at to get it to come around at all and be pleasing and bring forth fruit and sweat over and make it and da-da-da-da. It's called anything that's not Christ, including religion or trying to raise a family or, you know, on and on and on. All subjects and all categories fall there if it doesn't grow from the mist, the Holy Spirit, the mist that waters the garden, that comes down in the cool of the evening and waters that garden. You remember it says that in Genesis, if you're not familiar with it. It's not, oh, I gotta water this and I gotta water that, you know. Some people have a green thumb and some people don't. She has a brown thumb. that's also the time that Adam would walk with God in the cool of the evening. And they would commune. Just a picture, just a vague, very early shadow of something so natural, something that flows by life, something that you don't maintain. You live in it. I don't know how to put it. You don't maintain it. You're not always thinking about maintaining it. You are walking with God, and God is watering everything, and it's bringing forth fruit effortlessly because you're in union with the one that you're in. But then you sin, you have to be taken out, but he dies. You say, well, what about that tree of life? Oh, it shows up. It shows up in the end. That tree always shows up. That cross, it's always going to, you can't run from it. You go, oh, look, this river's flowing, and it's got, you know, what was it, 9 different kinds of fruit? I can't remember. I should know. 12. 12. Do I hear 13? It's 12. 12 different kinds of fruit. And, but there's still the tree of life there, you know, that is doing that and bringing forth. And everyone is aware of that all that is fruitful and all that is flowing, it's all related to the tree of life that Adam and Eve never partook of. Because they didn't know, they thought the plan was, put us in a garden where everything is done for us and bless us and let us just be happy all our days and let us have beautiful children. Cain, you know. It ain't going to happen without union with the Lord. It's going to get ugly. It's going to get ugly. And so what does that say to us here? It says that there is something deeply in the heart of the Lord. It's still there. It was there when we first got saved. It was there at the height of when we sought the Lord and when we were tender. It still remains there. It can still be found, but it's not going to be found by sitting in classes. I mean, classes aren't wrong, but it's wrong to sit in classes. You come and like Mary, you may be sitting in a chair or this or that, but you come and you sit at the feet of Jesus and you say, tell me of these things from your own mouth. And what else does it say? It says that maybe there's going to, and you know, this can be taken wrong, but I'm going to just say it like this and let the Holy Spirit sort it out. Maybe it's going to take the death of something loved dearly. Jerusalem was, you know, if I forget, remember in captivity, if I forget Jerusalem, may my, what is it, right hand lose its cunning and all, you know. They, at least some of them in captivity, recognized the loss and the price. And it was something they loved. Others didn't. So, you know, the loss of something that is brings the Lord and is so stable and everything for us, because it's, you know, how do you shake yourself and arise and go after the Lord? You know, that's such a difficult thing to do instantly. It takes a while. You know, it's like the Lord has a big container of tenderizer. And every day he has, you know, like this guy who knows how to grill, and you know, he puts tenderizer on there. And I don't know if you've ever seen tenderizer put on before, but a lot of times there's this thing with a whole bunch of little things like this, bam, 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 to the meat. Did you know that? Bam, 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 tenderizer, bam, bam. Go, oh, just pour tenderizer on me and I'll go, oh. You know, bam, bam is what it's going to take for you. You know what I'm saying? All right, so so that leads us up to chapter 5. And Adam and Eve are sent away wearing what? What? I think it said goat skin. There's two of them that left, so we know there are two goats involved in this thing. Good girl. Look it up. That's why you're in Bible school. That's what I want to see right there. Praise God. You're the first one in 12 years. No. We got one. Reel it in. We are here to be scripture searchers. What do you think? Maybe we ought to find somebody that they can read. It's good to search the scriptures, but it's better to read. Yeah, Scott. Right.
And, you know, I was kind of just asking the Holy Spirit about that. I said, Lord, you know, where does the want to come from? You know? And he said, this is like, the want to comes because it's like you're in an arranged marriage with Jesus. The Father has arranged this marriage. And as you draw near to him and discover,
sometimes. Amen. Well, just for your mother's sake, this was an incredible, she's on Skype, an incredible word from God if you weren't able to hear it. Your son is a sage. And we are blessed to have him, Carolyn. I just want you to know that. Deb? Coats or skins. Okay. All right. So I'm assuming that because the pattern. I don't know. It didn't say, but so we can't say definitively that that's the case. But the pattern says that somebody had to die so that somebody would be able to go into captivity. You know, the pattern. It's. So we won't hold to that one, but we have reason to suspect that that could be the case. All right. certainly, whatever animal it was, it died while Adam and Eve went into captivity. Okay. And by the way, this is all Romans 5, covered with... The atonement is verses 2 and 3. The goat died while they went into captivity is verse 8. And then verse 9 and 10. Before I read it, I'm gonna read my notes. Jesus is the return from captivity. He's not the returner, or he's not the one who brings about the return. It is a return to him, as said throughout the prophets, folks, over and over and over and over and over and over and over. And so Jesus is the return. Let's say it like this. When you come to God's ultimate intention in all of this, you will find that oneness with Jesus is the only thing that gets you free from everything else. The only thing. And we're going to see that in the second half of Romans 5. So Jesus is the return from captivity. He is the restoration. He is the return to what the land was always meant to be. We in him, be in the land. Get you out of Babylon. Flee Babylon. Well, he didn't just say, I don't like you there. Come to what his heart is. Not just trying to save you from something. He redeemed us. What's it say in Revelation? He redeemed us unto God. He didn't just redeem us from hell or from sin. He redeemed us unto God. Most people only see half of the redemption. You know, to see half of anything is called heresy. Did you know that? It is. It's not error, but it's heresy, which means only half the truth or part truth. That's what heresy means. So it's he is the return to what the land was always meant to be. We in him, that is. He is the tree of life. All right, so Romans 5, 9, and 10. Much more than being justified by his blood. Good, that gets you out. Amen? Amen? You have the right to remain silent. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled or brought out of Babylon or brought out of the wilderness, the land uninhabited, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. There's the land. There's the promised land. There's the land that flows with milk and honey. There's the garden that you don't have to water, that God sends down amidst and every evening and waters his own garden. This is Romans 5, and it is about to go into the second half. And in the second half, he is going to hammer this reality home over and over so that you can't miss it unless you miss it, which most people do, because all they see is the theology of, I think these are mine, aren't they? I think I brought these here. The theology of... being in Adam or in Christ, and the reality that through the cross we are no longer in sin, but we're saved, but we're in Christ. But being in Christ for so many has absolutely no practical value to them at all. None. It's like being married and being married having no actual effect on your identity. Really, you know. Scott was talking about arranged marriages. Does God still do that? He arranges them. Oh, he rearranges them too. To not have an all-out identity change, and here's what I mean by that. I don't mean a theological identity change. I don't mean go to church and say, yeah, theologically we're this and that. I mean a personal relationship identity change to Jesus. I'm not my own. I've been bought with a price, which in the case of Gomer in Hosea, she was bought, right? With a price. For what? So she wouldn't be a slave in the slave market. No. It was like, is that all you getting out of this, Gomer? Golly. Anyway, sorry. I don't know where this thing is. Sorry. See, I did it. I embarrassed myself. All right, let's get this thing back on track here. That's pretty funny, though. Yeah. You know, this relationship is, thank you for redeeming me. Thank you for paying my debt. Thank you for the clothes that you put on me that makes me look better than I did before I met you. But I didn't redeem you just to fix your messed up life in Babylon. And that's what a whole lot of Israel wanted, just to get their life fixed in Babylon. That's why the book of Revelation is full of this stuff about Babylon. Have you ever noticed that? I mean, that's where the captivity was supposed to come from. And in the very last book, God's still dealing with it. Because why? Because there's two views in the book of Revelation, always and forever. What's going on in heaven and what's going on in the earth. And Babylon's what's going on in the earth. And other things, lamb stuff's going on in heaven. But lamb stuff is going on in the earth. And you can trace the lamb through his people throughout. We read, and, you know, who was it? The dragon or the beast made war with the saints. We go, yeah, but don't worry, we win. No, it says he defeated him. But, you know, you go, well, either they're not good warriors or they're lambs. You know, the two witnesses slain publicly in the street. You know, oh my God, every time we start getting a foothold and stuff starts happening, we always die. Why is this? I don't get this book of Revelation. You don't get the lamb is what you don't get. Anyway, in the earth, you know, we say, well, the problem with in the earth is the beast. Right? That's what we say. Okay. So let me see if I can remember a picture here. And I looked and I saw a great harlot. I could have used other words. And she rode upon a beast. And the beast hated her. Huh? Huh? There is this tendency in us towards Babylon, and will always be there as long as we live in the earth, and as long as our life in the earth isn't Christ crucified, willing to die to bring forth something that couldn't come about any other way. Most people don't even know that principle. I mean, it's all about conquering. I would never want to be more than a conqueror. I just want to be a conqueror. I say that as someone who heard what more than a conqueror really is and goes, I just want to win. Oh, we'll win in the end, but here's how you do it. You know what? Here's the good news. That's Romans 8. We just might get to it, and I know you're thinking we may not, but I'm going to try to see to it, and we'll cover those very scriptures. It's undeniable. I mean, you try to deny it here, and you come to the next scripture, and it says, blah, 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 and you're, oh my God, I never noticed it said it like that, or I knew it said it like that, but I didn't know it meant that, but it's saying that, and now I see it. So we go, okay, I've just got this reprobate mind. Lord, help me. And he says, I gave you the reprobate mind, not the devil. What? Yeah, I gave you over unto all this stuff. Why would you do that to me? Well, why would you do that to me? What you did to me, you know? And if that's what you are, I'm not going to let you live in deception the whole time. I'll give you a space, and I'll let you live in that deception and say, I'm this because I'm here in Jerusalem, and we have the temple. Remember, that was always big stuff to them. Well, we've got the temple, you know, and God wouldn't destroy the temple. And you're talking about Jesus being the temple of God at that time. And Jesus said, 3 days. So there is so God gives a space. And when it doesn't happen, he says, okay, I'm gonna give you over to what you are, not just to what you want. Because in truth, once he gives you over to what you are, then you come into captivity to something else. I don't want to be a servant to the Lord, or I don't want to, you know. I remember one time on Maple and standing there greeting people, or they were going out, and one brother said to me, Brother Randy, I just want to be a floor mat in the house of God. And I said, first time somebody wipes their feet on you, you're going to throw a fit. You know, but it sounded good to him. You know, this sounds so good. Wait till actual foot wiping starts. Wait till people come up and go, and you're going to do, why? I'm a floor mat in the house of God. Why would you do that? You ask for it? Well, how about this? I would like for you to be that too. But deep in your heart, you want to be something else. So you're going to end up serving what you are. That's one of my pithy sayings. But I believe that there's some real truth to that. You know, if you're a criminal, you're going to end up serving in jail. You know how I know that? I know all about it. I'm supposed to get 25 years in the penitentiary. But God intervened and changed my heart, and then changed the jury's heart when I pleaded guilty after I got saved. Guilty. He went into court and said, I'm guilty. And the sentence they were asking for was 25 years. So the judge said, well, we'll throw it to the jury. And my attorney had no defense when I pled guilty. None. You can't say it. You can't bring in people to vouch for you. Because they go, he's guilty, for God's sake. He said he's guilty. And my attorney's going, well, what's my defense? And he said, you can put him on the stand. And, of course, you don't put people on the stand. You don't do that, because then they can be cross-examined. Put me on the stand. And the Lord told me to go. Be on the stand. He says, you will be dragged before kings and judges and this and that. And on that day, don't worry what you're going to say. I will put it in your mouth. I'm brand new Christian. I don't know beans about anything, but I read that and said, okay. Got up there. Bam. Spirit of God gave me exactly what to say. And, of course, that's under my attorney trying to guide the questions. So then he has to sit down and the prosecutor comes up. And he starts in. And I said, well, he said, so you think you got saved, huh? I said, yes, sir, I did. I didn't cut my hair or anything because the Lord told me it can't be based on you trying to convince them by outward appearance. Either they're going to know something's real in you or they're not. So don't try to fake anybody out. I'm sitting up there with my long hair and my hippie clothes. So you think you got saved, huh? Yes, sir, I did. He goes, do you know how many people that are in prison right now said they got saved? And they tried to get out of going to prison by saying that. I said, no, sir, but I'm not doing that. He said, well, you know, and he asked questions where I could answer. Usually they don't. It's yes or no. So I just told him my heart that something genuine had happened. And when he got done, I mean, you could hear a pin drop in that place. And the jury was just like, oh my gosh.
You said you would serve Jesus and be with Jesus.
Yeah, the prosecutor said, so, what are you going to do if you get 25 years in the penitentiary? I said, serve Jesus there. What do you mean, what am I going to do? I'm going to serve him wherever I'm at. If I go there, God wants me to be there, and I will serve him there. Everybody kind of went, you know. Anyway, long and short of it was that he got changed and thrown out, and more miracles happened on top of that and on top of that and on top of that. But the bottom line was, I was different. I was not the same guy that committed those things. I was no longer a drug addict. I was no longer a drug dealer. I was no longer any of that stuff. And I said, you end up getting the government, actually, that you deserve. Well, Randy, before Jesus, deserved prison. Randy, after Jesus, being one with him, it's like Balaam looking down over Israel and Balak trying to get him to curse. He says, I don't see iniquity in Israel, you know? And he said, I paid you to curse. Said, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the Son of Man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? And then he says to the king, behold, I have received commandment to bless, and I have blessed, and I cannot reverse it. That's who you are. Stop saying you're something else. Get in his heart. Get in his view and be one with him in a living way, on a way you think and the way you talk and the way, and it's all about him and it's not about him fixing us. Amen. Good time to break so you can all fall on your face and repent. Let's take a break.